to read the motion. Order, please. Please show courtesy to other members who wish to participate in this debate. And if you wish to leave, leave the chamber quietly and have your discussions outside. Order.
That this Assembly is extremely concerned at the number of bank branches that are being closed in rural areas. It is alarmed that large rural areas are without access to a local bank branch. Recognises the limitations of many of the alternatives, such as mobile and internet banking and the post office. Believes that the provision of accessible banking is an integral part of social inclusion with a particular impact on the elderly. Notes the negative economic impact bank closures have on small businesses and on future investment opportunities, and calls on the Minister for the Economy to intervene meaningfully and encourage the banking sector to maintain a strong network of rural bank branches and to safeguard the existing bank branches within these communities from closure.
Thank you. I call Mr. Richie McPhillips to move the motion. Mr. McPhillips.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, as a member for Fermanagh South Tyrone, I welcome the opportunity to bring today's motion to the Chamber, which concerns a huge amount of people in the rural area and businesses that have been and continue to be impacted by the decisions to close local banking facilities. Despite promises of no more bank closures back in 2013, on the 20th of July this year, the Bank of Ireland announced that it will close 8 of its existing branches, and these branches are in Castlereagh, Draperstown, Antrim, Beleek, Castledurg, Newton Ards, Mahara, Donegal Square South and Belfast. This decision, Mr. Speaker, has hit many individuals and businesses hard, especially those in rural communities. Mr. Speaker, before discussing the overall implications of the decision, I would like to first of all focus on the Beleek branch, where the decision has been met with anger and frustration, which is why 7,000 people signed a petition calling for a halt to these closures and the closure plans. I have witnessed it firsthand, along with my SDLP councillor colleague John Coyle and Ulster Unionist MLA for Fermanagh South Tyrone, Rosemary Barton. We visited the branch, its customers and local businesses to hear the concerns. But we have a background, Mr. Speaker. The Bank of Ireland branch in Beleek serves some 5,000 customers and it has done so successfully for decades. The branch is a lifeline for many people in the local area. It's a major part of the fabric that is supporting the vast majority of financial activity in the village for businesses and individuals. But the decision made by Bank of Ireland to close the branch has been devastating, especially for rural dwellers who have no access to other banks, and it is the last bank in the village. They're now having to travel considerable distances in order to avail of basic banking services such as Enniskillen and Lisnaskey and Irvinstown. This is despite the fact that an ISRA publication found that the Beleek area is the second most deprived area for access and proximity to local services within the north of this island. Mr. Speaker, the proposed closure will also impact on cross-border trade, as a number of large businesses from the Republic have accounts in Beleek and it's impractical for them to travel to Enniskillen or Lisnaskey. There's also the security issue, as many local businesses will have to transport vast sums of money in cash rather than depositing it locally. The closure of the bank will also have a negative impact on investment in the area. There's Beleek Pottery, and a new hotel has been proposed to open in the near future. With no local banking services, Mr. Speaker, this does not bode well for the future of the area. Mr. Speaker, last week, along with my SDLP colleagues, we met with Sean Sheehan, of the bank's Regional Director for the North, and Des Crawley, who is on the bank's Board of Directors. We specifically outlined these concerns, and it became clear that the decision has been made to increase profits rather than to look out for the people of Beleek and elsewhere and the thousands of people that use the bank. Mr. Speaker, turning to the Bank of Ireland's reasoning for their closures, in its statement, it mentions alternative banking and how important it is to move online. But when pressed on the issue, it became clear that the bank has made no assessment regarding access to internet and mobile phone services. I know firsthand that there are many people in Beleek that do not have a stable internet connection. The bank has made no assessment of what impact this will have for older people who may not have the tech savvy and may not be able to use computers. This simply can't be acceptable. The bank has also stated its intention to integrate banking services with local post offices, who are themselves facing many pressures. Gone are the days when you had a dedicated post office that was well staffed and offered an array of postal and financial services. Now they're crammed in the corner of a local shop. Therefore, the post office cannot be a realistic alternative for bank branches. It simply isn't able to deal with the heavy footfall, and it removes the privacy aspect of local banking that we all have become accustomed to. Another possibility being considered by the Bank of Ireland, for the Bleak branch at least, is the linking of Bleak services with Ballyshannon in Donegal. But again, when pressed further on the issue, it seems that Brexit decision and future financial uncertainty means that this option is also highly unlikely. Mr Speaker, I am not satisfied, nor indeed with my colleagues, at the proposed alternative arrangements, nor am I satisfied that a proper engagement and consultation process has or has been completed. Staff, customers and businesses have been left completely in the dark. This is despite the fact that last year the banking sector came together in Westminster to agree the Access to Banking Protocol, which sets out specific requirements for closing a bank. These include the adequacy of alternative banking services and customer and staffing engagement. None of this has taken place to date, and it's important that we in this chamber challenge the bank on whether it is using this protocol. There are 54 staff impacted by the decision across the north, Mr Speaker, who are now left in uncertain circumstances. They either have to take redundancy or travel miles to get to and from their work, which, if you live in Bleak, comes as a massive inconvenience. Mr Speaker, it's against this backdrop that I find it crucial that this chamber sends a direct message to the Bank of Ireland and to the wider banking services that we will not sit back and allow the gradual erosion of local and rural services. For far too long, rural communities have been stripped of services by banks and other institutions with little challenge and little ramifications. We talk lots about reducing corporation tax and giving our banks massive tax cuts. Well, what about a reduction in corporation tax, having social clauses that must be a commitment to rural banking services to avail of any tax break? Mr Speaker, we in this Assembly need to make a statement that rural bank closures are unacceptable, especially when it is the last bank in an area. It will be detrimental to farmers, to SMEs and investment in the area. I want this chamber to be proactive rather than reactive in the short term. In the short term, I request the Minister to engage with the Bank of Ireland to outline our concerns, and that he meets with Des Crawley, who is on the board of directors in London. But, Mr Speaker, in the long term, it is my belief that the Assembly needs to make a clear statement that we will not sit back and allow the gradual erosion of services by stealth, and we must review this situation and consider whether legislation would be appropriate to safeguard banking services. To address the Sinn Féin amendment, it remains clear that rural broadband and mobile phone connectivity is not up to speed, and that is why the SDLP brought a motion to this chamber in June. However, what the SDLP or the Sinn Féin failed to recognise is that the issue is much greater than connectivity. It's about access to banking services within rural communities. Internet and mobile banking cannot be a substitute for local face-to-face banking, and it cannot be used as an excuse to rubber stamp these vital services. In this regard, Mr Speaker, I urge support for this motion, and as proposed, and I cannot accept the Sinn Féin amendment. Thank you.
Order. Thank you. I call Caoimhe Archibald to move the amendment.
I'd like to thank the proposers of the motion for raising this important issue. We believe our amendment adds to the spirit of the motion, which is in ensuring equivalence of service delivery for rural dwellers. I was supportive of the original motion as a representative of a constituency with large rural areas and a member of the ERA committee. I am well aware of the many issues affecting rural constituents in terms of service. There have been a number of branch closures across the north, as Mr McFullis has pointed out, the most recent in July. And as he said, this represents a loss of local jobs as well as the service. A few weeks ago, the Federation of Small Businesses presented to the Economy Committee, and I asked if there were specific issues for rural small businesses. The two points raised were the importance of rural banks and rural crime. It was pointed out that small businesses need to be able to deposit cash, and it is a security risk for them to travel or keep money in a safe. It was also highlighted that there's footfall associated with local bank branches and for other cafes and shops, etc., in a small town or village, which can be lost when a branch closes. For personal banking, there are, of course, those who prefer or need to avail of in-branch services for particular transactions. In terms of our amendment, however, it cannot be ignored that the way people bank has changed in the past decade. Online banking is now used by around 60% of our population for a range of transactions. For example, some 33% of Barclays personal loan applications are done online. Mobile apps are increasingly the method of choice for many banking transactions. For example, Halifax state that 65% of its online banking is done via mobile app. Many rural dwellers who don't have access to transport, it is imperative for them to have access to online or mobile banking. This could be households with a single earner in one car where a parent is at home with kids, rural dwellers who are unemployed, long-term sick or have a disability. In this instance, people may be unable to travel to the nearest branch. It is therefore necessary to have adequate broadband or mobile phone coverage. Many of our most isolated areas suffer from a lack of services in general, including public transport, and so the loss of a local bank branch exacerbates an inequality in service, which is already there. It cannot be ignored either that there has been a reduction in numbers of in-branch transactions and fewer people may be using branches, but banks should be encouraged to look at more innovative or imaginative solutions than simply closing branches. Reduced hours is one option, or if reducing overheads is an issue, then sharing premises with shops, other banks in the town or post offices, or delivering a full range of services through a post office branch. I do acknowledge what Mr. McPhillips said about privacy, and that is something which needs to be addressed. This would ensure that the full spectrum of service remains within the locality. While acknowledging the Minister has limited say in the business decisions of individual banks, all possible influence should be exerted to encourage these types of initiatives. Laois Cathain Cóirlí, there have been many debates and discussions about the need for better broadband provision and mobile coverage in rural areas, and a great deal of investment has been put into mobile and broadband infrastructure. I acknowledge again that the Minister has previously said about not wanting to allow a situation to develop where there's two levels of service for urban and rural areas, and I welcome that. Unfortunately, though, that may already be the case in some areas. It's very frustrating for individuals, be it for home or business broadband, to be told they're just outside the scope of decent delivery. And it's equally frustrating as a rep to be told the same and not to be able to offer a solution to these individuals. I could stand here and list areas with no or very poor coverage, but so could many other members. And I'm sure the providers are aware of where they are. That information now needs to be collated and the issue tackled. That is why we are calling for the Minister to commit to a programme to identify the pockets of areas with poor broadband or mobile coverage and to hold the providers to account to ensure they target these areas in a systematic way. There's also a role for local councils in this, and some have plans already in this regard. A targeted action plan should be developed to deliver at least basic broadband over a set period of time to all areas. This is a piece of work that will become necessary with the Universal Service Obligation. It is expected there may be some clawback of investment to BT, which could be redirected towards a project like this. Broadband and mobile coverage are no longer luxury commodities, but necessary utilities like water and electricity. A requirement for SMEs to do business, expected in households for educational and entertainment purposes alike. It's no use telling people who live in those areas affected that 48,000 premises have been connected via the Broadband Improvement Scheme. They only want to know when they too might be connected. In conclusion, I'm supporting the motion and commend the amendment to address the disparity in service provision to rural dwellers. Gur Maggot.
Thank you. I call Mr. Tom Buchanan.
Mr. Speaker, the closure of banks within the rural area is a very, very emotive issue for any community, and instills a fear in the heart of that community that here is another loss within a rural area. And far too often within the rural areas we're seeing losses of businesses and banks and post offices and other issues that we must stand firmly against. Loss of a facility which has been in situ for many, many years. It forms part of the very fabric of that society, and I think it's fair to say that in many areas has been used and utilised from the cradle to the grave. Family members, father, grandfather, and siblings right along have used it, and from a child is born there's an account that's opened in the bank for them, and it's used right along, and that family member and other families are brought in and that bank has been utilised, and the closure of that within an area then causes a huge gap and a huge concern for the people in that community, and therefore the removal of the facility. And that face-to-face encounter with a member of staff creates a huge gap for all those who still prefer this method of banking. It is a huge knock-on effect on the footfall of a town or village and a negative impact on many of our local businesses within the area. The local branch manager understands the difficulties and challenges facing many businesses, from the small to medium enterprises right through to the agriculture industry, which depends so much on that knowledge and flexibility to allow growth within their business. Unfortunately, that relationship with the managers is being lost, placing huge pressure on some of these businesses. In fact, I've been working with businesses who have now found, with their local branch gone, they have extreme difficulty in even securing a meeting with a senior member of that bank to sort out what are simply very simple financial pressures within their business. And again, that is as a direct result of the loss of the branch within their local area. As I look across my own constituency of West Tyrone, large rural constituency, the number of banks which have already closed and are proposing to close is alarming. And to mention one area in particular, in the past few years, Castle Derg has been reduced from 3 banks to 1. And our rural villages are not only losing their banks, but in some cases are losing their post offices as well. And this is really stripping the rural areas of a facility that is so essential for them. While we understand that right across Northern Ireland there is a focus on changing how banking should be done in the future, for example through internet banking and other methods, that simply doesn't work within our rural areas such as our small towns and villages. The lack of broadband availability puts dividend to that, where many rural dwellers and small businesses don't have adequate access to broadband services, and therefore they are at a loss even to contemplate doing internet banking. And regardless of how advanced online banking may become, these people making the decisions must take into consideration the infrastructure difficulties which exist and the extreme pressures which branch closures are placing on the rural communities. For example, many individuals and small businesses are now being forced to travel round trips of anything up to 50 miles to access their banking facilities, which also creates a security issue for the small business sector. Lack of consultation between customers, the community, elected representatives and the banks prior to any closure is practically non-existent, with many customers and members of the community not being made aware of proposed closures until they read it in the local press. Yeah.
I thank the member for giving way. Will the member agree with me that when it comes to these closures, we're seeing a further 8 close now from the 19 originally in relation to the Bank of Ireland? The Chief Executive told us this week that in our constituency in Castle Derg, the bank was in profit, as it was in Bleak. Does the member agree with me that this is about profit in the bank and not about people?
The member has an extra minute.
Thank you. Well, that appears to be what the issue is. It's no longer, it doesn't seem to be any longer people focused. So a much more rigorous impact assessment and consultation exercise should and must be conducted by the banks with customers and the community who are likely to be affected by any closure prior to the axe falling on the closure of any branch. And for the benefit of the rural areas, and the small business sector in particular, where we find the most of them within the rural areas, it is essential then that the Minister, who we're glad is with us today for this debate, in the limited role that he has in this matter, that he intervene in some meaningful way to seek to safeguard the existing branches that we have within our rural areas, to seek to protect our rural areas from any further closures, because every time we get a closure of a branch within our rural communities, then it's a huge detrimental impact on that area and it's a huge loss. So we'd ask the Minister to intervene and do what he can possibly do in order to seek to stop and prohibit the closure of these branches.
Thank you very much indeed. I call Rosemary Barton.
Mr Deputy Speaker, thank you for the opportunity to participate on this bank closure debate this afternoon. I too support my constituents in their effort to halt the closure of the last remaining bank in the town of Baleek. From 2010 to 2014, 77 branches in the overall banking network in Northern Ireland had closed, a third of all branches, and since 2014 this closure programme has accelerated, leaving many towns and villages without any form of banking. This is particularly prevalent in my own constituency of Fermanagh and South Tyrone. A number of members of this House this afternoon have outlined the socio and economic reasons why banks must remain open. Yes, we all realise that banking is changing, but at least one bank needs to be operational in the larger villages, given the actual landmass of the county. How many people in this chamber would endure an all-round trip of 50 or 60 miles to a bank several times a week to do business together with the risks of transporting cash? Very few, I assume. We are told the reason the bank is closing is because of the reduced footfall due to declining business. In the past 2 years, two other banks in Baleek have closed. What has the Bank of Ireland done to encourage new business? What incentives did it offer those customers from the other banks to change their account and make the Bank of Ireland in Baleek more viable? The banks have to change from their single-mindedness of using a decreasing footfall as an excuse to close a bank. They must make a greater effort to entice more clients with larger incentives. Presently, it looks as if the banks do not want the bother of providing a service to rural customers. I understand also that due to accounting procedures, the more lucrative income from business and mortgages is not now counted in the bank income measurement, thus accelerating the rate of closures in rural areas, such as Baleek. Since 2013, the Bank of Ireland has closed 17 branches in Northern Ireland, leaving only 28 operational. I hope this is not the thin end of the wedge, with the Bank of Ireland closing all its branches. Again, the excuse that customers are doing their banking by internet is not acceptable. Of those who have access to the internet, only 51% use the internet for online banking, compared to the average figure in the UK of 60%. This access to the internet and poor mobile infrastructure certainly is a huge disadvantage economically for Baleek area. And this is a gigantic issue that this executive has still to address successfully. The Bank of Ireland speak of 365 online, and I quote, offering the convenience and flexibility to do day-to-day banking at any time. Has the Bank of Ireland in Baleek considered working with the community and the executive to jointly finance a state-of-the-art mobile and online infrastructure to ensure the success of their 365 online in Baleek, so that the digital banking will be accessible for the people of the Baleek area? Time and time again, one is told by the bank about its good customer service. The threat of closure certainly does not indicate this, nor the manner in which the bank customers learned of the proposed closure. There is also no evidence that the Bank of Ireland assessed the impact on the local community of this closure. My constituents, Mr Deputy Speaker, in Fermanagh, South Tyrone, deserve better than bank after bank being under threat of closure or being closed. While Baleek Town is relatively small, It has a vibrant community, a world-famous pottery, with a thriving tourist industry. I therefore urge the Executive to intervene, meet with the Bank of Ireland Chief Executive, and do everything to prevent the proposed closure. Yeah. Mr Deputy Speaker, I support the motion.
Thank you. I call Kelly Armstrong.
Thank you very much. Mr Deputy Speaker, on behalf of the Alliance Party, I rise to support both the motion and the amendment. As a rural dweller and as the representative of the largely rural constituency of Strangford, I have seen firsthand how the closure of local bank branches has had a negative impact, particularly on older citizens and small rural businesses. Wilfred Mitchell, policy chair of the FSB, noted the unwelcome rural focus of bank closures across Northern Ireland over recent years. I've heard from constituents how they do not want to discuss personal banking requirements over the post office counter, especially when that counter is located in the garage forecourt, where their neighbours are next in the queue waiting for their milk. I've heard from constituents where the post office alternative is no longer available because even the post office in that village has since closed. Or indeed, where the local post office is based in a village that you cannot travel to using public transport because the rural village-to-village route has been removed, and the only local taxi does school runs during the week and pub runs at the weekend. While 60% may use online banking, I have heard from those constituents frustrated that online banking is often the only alternative offered, and when that elderly citizen never uses a smartphone. There may well be limited broadband in their area, but they do not have or want to have an expensive computer, tablet or smartphone, or can afford to have broadband in their home. I believe the opinions of rural dwellers and businesses are not being considered enough. In a press release following the announcement of the closure of a number of Bank of Ireland branches, the bank stated the decision was not taken lightly and noted customers would be disappointed. Customers were and remain more than disappointed. They feel abandoned, disillusioned by high street banks that have given little or no consideration to the impact closing a local branch has on the community and small businesses. During the financial crisis, customers stayed loyal to local branches and banks. Now those same customers are being abandoned. Indeed, Larry Broderick of the Financial Services Union stated branch closures were irresponsible given the announcement of significant profits being made. Therefore, it is appropriate that the Minister does engage with banks to encourage the sector to maintain a network of rural branches. The pace of bank closures has accelerated rapidly over the recent years. The British Bankers Association investigated lending data and found that bank closures dampen SME lending growth by 63%. This figure rose to 104% in areas that have lost their last bank. This has a significant and damaging drop in funding for areas that are already under commercial and economic pressure. I fully appreciate that banking is a reserved matter, and the Department has no statutory oversight of the banking sector. However, where there is market failure, there needs to be intervention by government to address issues that are having such a negative impact on the public and at the same time hindering small businesses. Therefore, I ask the Minister, if the Minister accepts this is market failure, and if he does, then does he acknowledge the need for government to intervene as brought forward by both the motion and the amendment today? One way the Minister could help is by encouraging banks to look again at their balance between profit and social responsibility, to encourage banks to treat rural customers fairly by replicating the protocol on bank closures as agreed by the British Bankers Association, where high street banks, consumer groups and government signed up to an industry-wide agreement to minimise the impact of bank closures on local communities. It is not appropriate for banks to simply state that online banking or the post office are appropriate alternatives to a local branch. If appropriate consultation with the community was completed, then the bank would have to address if broadband access was available, enabling online banking to be a reasonable alternative. And they would also have to consider those customers that do not use online banking. In my constituency, broadband and mobile phone signal may be available, but the speed and strength is so limited it makes using a smartphone or computer to bank difficult and impossible in some areas. There are, of course, a generation of bank customers who are used to speaking to a local bank manager, and those people will never use online banking, no matter how good the broadband capacity is. In my own family, my own father and my mother-in-law do not use online banking. They do not trust it or want to use it and wouldn't. For this generation, they need to be able to speak to a human being in person. The fear of computer glitches, and let's face it, many banking customers in Northern Ireland have faced significant difficulty thanks to computer glitches over recent years. Their fear of cybercrime and computer hackers means they have little trust in online banking. What alternative is available for them? Banks have said the Post Office provides local banking. In my constituency, the Post Office is having its own problems delivering local rural services. A number of local Post Office providers have pulled out. This includes in Kirkcaldy, Corridor and Portavogie and many other small villages. While the Post Office tries to find another shop or garage to take on the services, many villages are being left.
Remarks.
Thank you. Many places are left without an alternative. So I ask, therefore, that the Minister takes forward a protocol on banking closures like the one agreed by the BBA in 2015
Members,
and considers the Move Your Money report.
Thank you very much indeed. I call Mr. William Irwin.
Can I say this is a matter which has particular relevance to my own constituency, where in a matter of a few months a number of rural banking branches withdrew from the towns within the Newry and Armagh constituency. Tandragee, first of all, lost the Danske Bank branch, and many customers who were less mobile and indeed business in the town who enjoyed the accessibility to a branch, banking branch in the town then switched to the remaining bank in the town, which was the Ulster Bank, only for it then to close a few months later. This had a negative impact on the town of Tandragee, with a noted decrease in the number of people stopping in the town, and then has had a negative knock-on effect on local businesses in the town. Newton Hamilton lost its only banking branch, as did Market Hill, which in reality means that over a very large area, the only physical branch-based banking services are in Newry City and Armagh City. That continues to be a significant issue for both businesses and, of course, the general public, who now have to travel much greater distances to do their banking. I have liaised with various banks, and I was successful in encouraging Ulster Bank to operate a mobile bank in Tandragee one day a week, which has been of some assistance to local people. However, it has limited services on board. It is no substitute for a permanent branch in the town. I recall in the weeks leading up to the closure announcements, holding various meetings with the banking institutions, and I put forward strong arguments for the retention of services in each of the respective areas. However, the defence for the banks to closures was consistently based on the rise of internet banking and the costs of operating a branch versus the financial benefit to the bank. It is, in my view, unacceptable that banks feel that they can just withdraw such a vital service from a town, especially given that the general public and various businesses have given the bank loyal service over many years, in many cases even for decades. Those members of the public and local businesses that I have spoken with remain very dissatisfied with the decision of banks in my constituency to withdraw their branch services. And indeed, some of those banks in recent times have made record profits in Northern Ireland. The argument of internet banking rising in popularity is, of course, no surprise, and in many respects represents a convenient opportunity to check in your accounts at any time, day or night, and indeed in any place. However, not everyone is comfortable with this form of technology, and not everyone has access to either 4G mobile phone data signal or a suitable broadband speed to permit the use of online banking by computer. This represents an issue for those either without the technology or those uncomfortable using the technology. And for those in that position within my own constituency, it means a significant journey to access branch services elsewhere. And of course, it poses a real problem for the elderly and those without suitable transport. I would certainly encourage our Finance Minister to continue to liaise with our banking institutions and impress on them the requirement to maintain branch networks, particularly in rural areas where towns have been negatively impacted by branch closures.
Thank you. I call Declan McAleer.
Margaret, last Tranquilla, and I am very grateful for this opportunity to speak in this today's debate, and I commend the proposal for bringing it forward. Banking and access to financial services are absolutely very important for local people, and this is especially true in areas where there really are very few basic services. And if we take areas such as like Owen Callew, one of the areas I represent, it's the number one most deprived area in the north of Ireland in terms of access to basic services. So it's very important that we look at banking services, financial services, in the context of wider services to meet the needs of the people in the area. Just recently, we marked the successful conclusion of the Rural Development Programme. There was created over 1,000 jobs in the last 5 years, investment of £100 million, and we're looking forward to the new one. So it's very disappointing when we contrast that good news story of investment and development and in our rural areas against this backdrop of the stripping back of important financial services in our local areas. The issue of broadband, which is part of the motion which our party has raised today, throughout the north of Ireland there are many, many knot spots, and these are particularly prevalent, particularly in rural areas. And part of the area that I represent, along with others in the chamber here today, is the Spearns region. And the Spearns is very, very many knot spots in the area where broadband is not available. And this was a subject of debate here in the chamber just in June, just after the election. Indeed, last week, myself and Barry McAuldoff, MLA, and Pat Doherty, MP, we followed up that debate with a meeting with Ofcom to discuss the issues which people face in the area in terms of broadband. So it is a massive, massive issue, and I'm glad it's been included here in the amendment today. As I said, the issue of bank closures is very, very big in the West Rome constituency, like many other areas. And indeed, I was personally involved in the campaign around the Ulster Bank in Gorton and engaged with all of the businesses in the local area, the GA Club, the local community. And very, very, very big issue. And, you know, certainly the sense that I got was dealing with people was they felt let down. They felt that they had given decades and decades of valuable service to these local branches.
Thank you very much. Just when you talk about there people feeling let down, does the member agree with me if, as the Swiss bank USB predicts, we will, and they say that we'll see another 50% of bank closures in the UK in the next 10 years, that this is only a problem that's going to exacerbate?
Member, is an additional amount?
Yes, and that was a very timely intervention as well, Kelly. Just was coming to and we're looking at certainly in the Bank of Ireland and other swathe closures. Indeed, there's in the region of 8 banks which are in the pipeline for closure here across the north, one of them being in Castledarg in the West Tyrone constituency. And indeed, my colleague Pat Doherty, the MP for the area, a number of weeks ago met with Des Crowley in Westminster to discuss this here. And the sense that he got was the same sense that we got when we met the bank chiefs before, that these are based on business decisions, they're economic decisions, and you just get this very sort of sense that these things are foregone conclusions. And I think the message that's coming out there, you know, for banks is that, you know, these are people, these are customers, these are communities who have been loyal for decades and decades, yet they don't feel that their loyalty has been reciprocated. And I think banks need to look at their social responsibility as well as just looking at whether an economic case for keeping a bank stays or doesn't stay. And just a few months ago as well, we marked the conclusion of the Rural Needs Bill. This is the first region of Europe to have rural needs, rural proofing enshrined in legislation. The south of Ireland will be coming into line hopefully within the next year as well. And in that there, it put a statutory duty on public authorities to pay due regard to the needs of rural dwellers in terms of the impact of the decisions they make. Now, it's beyond the legislative competence of such an act to include banks in the face of the bill, but I think that's a challenge for banks. They need to rural-proof their decisions. They need to look at the impact it's having in local areas, and they need to reciprocate the loyalty that they've been getting from people for decades and decades here. So in conclusion, as I said at the outset, banking and access to financial services can't be seen in isolation from other services and areas such as access to GPs, transport, youth services, caring services. I think it's our responsibility as a legislative assembly to give voice to those people who feel let down, who feel cut off, to businesses, to cash businesses in rural areas who feel vulnerable having to go some distance to the bank in the nearest town to deposit cash. Sporting clubs, GAA clubs and others who also need their local banks to deposit cash, and of course older and vulnerable people who maybe can't get to their town or maybe are in a broadband knot spot, of which there are many throughout the north. So in conclusion, it's our duty to speak up to prevent the closure of these banks, to make banks see their social responsibilities and do whatever we can to prevent the overall decline and decimation of our services in rural areas. Graham Agoff.
Thank you. I call Mr. Gordon Dunn.
Speaker, and I too welcome the opportunity to speak on this motion today as a member of the Economy Committee. This is an important issue that affects so many across Northern Ireland. The reality is that it is not an exclusive local problem to Northern Ireland. Since 2010, it is reckoned that over 30% of bank branches, some 77, have closed right across the province. It is also estimated that some 1,700 bank branches have closed their doors across the UK in the past 5 years. Any closure can have a real and severe impact upon many in today's society, including our older population, those who are less mobile, those who have many disabilities, and those on lower incomes, and those who may have the resources, who may not have the resources or the skills required to manage their own bank account online. There is no doubt that bank closures have a real effect on so many. They have a negative impact on the small businesses within our towns who rely on the banks daily for lodgements and getting access to money. Any closure also leaves a vacant hole within our town centres, which can often be very difficult to fill with reduced footfall and the effects from that. People in Northern Ireland still like face-to-face service when they get within a bank. It gives them confidence and convenience in relation to their banking requirements. They build up relationships and trust with staff, which has been over many years. There is also the element of security. With no bank facility, householders and businesses may end up having to store large amounts of money within their own four walls, which presents a risk to themselves personally. In my own constituency of North Down, Holyrood has been left with one bank. We originally had three banks. The First Trust Bank closed in 2013, and the Danske Bank closed in 2014. Also, Donaghadee has lost their bank. There's no bank. There's no bank in Donaghadee, and the village of Mullail nearby has no bank either. I understand that there's a further 9 Ulster Bank branches under threat. Local people really feel that these closures feel the impact of them, and there is no doubt the reduction of service when these banks close. Closures are often carried out with no consultation in the local community and leave many local customers feeling let down, frustrated and concerned. In the case of the Holyrood Danske Bank closure, I got a phone call to my office saying the bank was going to close within 3 months. Totally out of the blue, it was a shock to everyone, and especially to the local community. There was no consultation. We certainly had a number of meetings with senior bank officials, but no one listened, and the decision was made. Certainly, online banking has transformed the way many people bank, and the digital age of mobile banking with online transfers and credit cards has radically changed the whole sector. However, banks must do more to protect our most vulnerable, ensure they are looked after and respect their customers' needs and requirements. Another real frustration is the lunchtime closing of banks, where the customers are standing outside the door trying to get in. They talk about customer focus. They talk about putting people first. It seems to be all about putting profits first. Whilst alternative facilities in post offices go some way to soften the blow following a bank closure, They can often be very busy places in themselves and understandably not able to carry out the full range of services which a traditional bank branch can offer over a counter with dedicated financial staff. During the last Enterprise Committee, we met regularly with those from the banking sector and other agencies such as the Consumer Council on these issues, and we have always raised the need for a strong branch network across Northern Ireland to be sustained. I know the Minister, Simon Hamilton, has a long interest in this issue, and I know he will continue to fight the case for our local communities in the future. Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker.
I call Steve Aiken.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Principal Speaker. I commend the SDLP for bringing forward this important and wide-ranging motion for debate, which we will, of course, be supporting. The issue of rural bank closures affects all our constituencies, both urban and rural. But most acutely, I would suggest, Madam Deputy Speaker, in our rural constituencies like my own in South Antrim and our adjoining constituencies of East Antrim and North Antrim, the bank closures have had a considerable effect. To quote Rachel Gray, Head of Money Affairs at the Consumer Council in Northern Ireland, By next February, Northern Ireland's Big Four banks will have closed 77 branches in the last 4 years. That's 31% of the bank branch network. And despite an increase in online banking, she has stated that their research has shown that bank customers still want access to local services for the reasons we've already heard, with 68% of customers surveyed saying that they visit a bank branch at least once in the last month. This is not just an issue for County Antrim or even for Northern Ireland. It's a much wider issue that goes across all of these islands. However, we in Northern Ireland are particularly hard hit because of the dispersed and rural nature of our towns and villages and the generally poor nature of our rural broadband and internet coverage and 4G mobile coverage. It's been said that technology changes and it's a sign of progress that bank branches have been thinned out and closed down. It's been said in the age of superfast broadband internet and smartphones that the need for local bank branches has diminished to a point where they're virtually extinct. However, I think we should have a word of caution to these to say that internet banking is wholly the method of the future. And face-to-face banking is in a physical building, interacting with trained clerical staff is a thing of the past. If we look at the recent report from the Federation of Small Businesses in Northern Ireland, it has highlighted the problems for small businesses. The time spent physically to travel 50 or 60 miles on a round trip and the time that's taken out of the business, the security aspects of transporting large volumes of cash and cheques, and the impact in sort of rural communities and villages and towns of the lack of footfall when the bank closes. On specific issues of online accounts, the question many people will ask is around about security and how secure is my actual account. Indeed, the British Banking Association over 16 years ago published an academic report that said, "Banking without branches, a study of how people conduct their banking business. Remote banking, technical solutions, and even unattended deposit facilities appear not to command widespread trust amongst isolated bank users. And banks will need to work hard if they wish to market these as alternatives for branch for the future for types of the customer." We do recognise that some banks, in particular the likes of Ulster Bank, has introduced mobile banking, but that is not enough. And that is not a substitute for proper banking facilities and where they are. So, Madam Deputy Speaker, bank closures in small towns and villages have hit our communities hard in recent years. It is an islands-wide phenomenon. At least we all understand that individual banks will have to make their decisions on bank closures for their own commercial reasons. But for some of us, it does smack of issues to do around profit. However, this debate will have been worthwhile if it raises and the understanding of this issue, and it would be helpful if the Minister in his summing up could clarify what role the regional government can play and will play in mitigating the effects of bank closures, particularly in the rural areas. Madam Deputy Speaker, thank you.
Here I'm Sir Patsy McLone. I call Patsy McLone.
Thanks very much, Principal Deputy Speaker. On this particular issue, as we stand here today, it's not just while a lot of reference has been made to the Bank of Ireland and how it has impacted, and indeed they've beaten a retreat from two branches within my own constituency, both Draperstown and Mahara. And in essence, what we've got now in Mahara is in recent times we've had Danske and Bank of Ireland now both announcing, indeed the Danske is long vacated in the last year, both within the town centre, both virtually facing one another, so you've got a void there. And that void in itself, as people say, okay, it's just a building, but it's the service that's provided to those communities. And as I speak here today, yes, I speak about my own constituency and on the periphery of it, Portland Own, Danske closed it too. And a lot of people from that lower end of South Derry did their business in the Portland Own branch. So what we're seeing is it appears to be the gradual retreat of the branches, of banks, from particularly those rural communities that they serve. And, okay, well, we've heard and we hear time and time and time again this issue of what she can do online banking, issues of footfall, increased numbers of people doing online. That's true. That may well be the case. But there are many, many people who, A, don't have access to internet, as has been amply outlined earlier, B, they certainly don't have it on their smartphones, and the third element to it is there are people in society, mainly older people, who don't do the online stuff, don't get the online stuff, won't ever be able to do it. And of course there are others who have learning disabilities that prevents them from doing that. and where that support of the one-to-one interface and exchange is crucially important. So, as I see it, our rural areas, the banks are beating a retreat from it. And these aren't non-productive rural areas. I can cite in my own case, Draperstown and Mahara. If we look at in that particular area, and I'm sure the Minister can verify that from stats from his own department, the number of self-starters, the number of self-employed people, the number of very, very productive businesses, many of which are into manufacturing and exporting, are within that general area. And the banks actually get this. They say, yes, we know, yes, we know. And what are they doing about it? They're withdrawing their services from those areas. Now, and I think nobody could have put it better from the business perspective. I've dealt with the individual and the community perspective. FSB, they refer to footfall. When a bank branch closes, particularly in rural area, there's a knock-on effect in terms of reduced footfall in that town or village, which impacts negatively on other local business. Of course it does. If you aren't bringing people into town or you haven't got the footfall in the streets, that's not going to happen. Other businesses will be affected, be they retail or service sectors. Time taken. Some people are being forced to travel up to 50 miles in a round trip. Now, that's time away from their home, away from their business, away from other duties that some cannot simply afford to do. Relationship managers. The in-branch relationship manager who didn't just provide advice, they understood the locality, they understood the area, and they understood the needs of the actual customers. They're not going to be there. Post office staff, we can't expect them to be able to advise on facilities through banking, on overdraft, and other necessities that are required from and with the bank. Security, it has already been referred to, and indeed many of us know businesses that have had their homes ransacked by criminals looking for money in the past. Access, direct access for those businesses to overnight facilities or night safes or whatever it might be with banks is crucially important, particularly where there's a rapid cash flow within those businesses. The access to broadband, I've already mentioned it. And again, customers' needs. And this is very important. FSB, the Federation of Small Business, have done their work. They have taken a focus group themselves, and members told them that the proportion of cash or cheque transactions in their businesses ranged from 50 to 95% of that focus group. So therefore, the closure of nearby branches will have a significant impact upon them. So I support the motion, and Gura Mayagat as Chancellor Lorch. Thank you very much, Principal Deputy Speaker.
Gura Mayagat. I call Minister for the Economy, Simon Hamilton, who will have 15 minutes to respond to the debate.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. Principal Deputy Speaker, I've listened with interest to the debate today, and I welcome the opportunity to respond to this motion, even though, as several speakers have pointed out, my department, or indeed any department within the executive, doesn't have direct responsibility for banks in Northern Ireland, but it is nonetheless an important issue and rightly raised on this floor. Principal Deputy Speaker, the number of bank closures, particularly in rural areas, is a very real concern for the many customers, both local businesses and the wider community, who rely on the services of their local bank. We must, of course, acknowledge that there has been a major shift in how we engage and interact with our high street banks. The services of the high street banks in Northern Ireland have traditionally been delivered through an extensive network of branches. However, it's indisputable that branch usage is not as high as it once was. As financial innovation has increased, trends in society have seen falls in the demand for traditional banking methods and a significant rise in the use of online banking and electronic payment methods. Recent data from the British Banking Association shows that the number of bank branch transactions across the whole of the United Kingdom has fallen to an average of 4 per customer per year. The BBA calculates the average branch in the UK receives 71 visits per day. That's a 32% fall since 2011. Principal Deputy Speaker, I raise these issues certainly not with the intention of sounding like a spokesperson for the banks. I have a tough enough job without taking that one on. But I think, as many members have acknowledged, we are changing our behaviour and how we interact, not just with banks, but a whole range of with retail and with a lot of other services, and indeed with government services as well. The BBA also showed that there's been a 50% rise to 11 million per day in banking and banking app logins in 2015. The Bank of Ireland, who are understandably the eye of the storm in today's debate because of their recent announcements, are suggesting that as low as 2% of customer transactions are now done in branch. There's been a 20% increase in online customers in the last 2 years, and that 2 years ago, 70% of mortgages were sold directly via branches or on the phone. That has now flipped the other way, and it's now 70% are sold via mortgage intermediaries, so without interaction in branches at all. So it's that changing behaviour, driven by largely technological change, combined with the impact of the financial crisis and new regulatory costs, has made banks across the UK, across Ireland, across the world look at the viability of their branch networks. Unfortunately, in Northern Ireland, we have seen in the last few months, as mentioned, an announcement from the Bank of Ireland that they propose to close 8 branches across Northern Ireland. Since 2010, 104 bank branches have closed here, and this has left us with 252 branches across Northern Ireland. Principal Deputy Speaker, I believe that the role of high street banks in our society is still essential. They play a valuable role in our communities. Many people believe that the Northern Ireland high street banks could have done more for their customers, especially those in rural areas, as they have tried to concentrate their branches in major centres of population or close their branches in favour of online banking. With each closure, the impacts for both domestic and business customers can be considerable. Businesses suffer from reduced footfall, cash flow shortages and concerns around the security of cash lodgements, whereas domestic customers can feel more isolated and excluded from society. The impact of these closures has been felt in rural areas and places where no suitable alternatives to bank branches exist. Principal Deputy Speaker, Northern Ireland already has a high number of unbanked consumers, around 10%, compared to the rest of the UK, which is at 4%. It's important, therefore, that we do not unnecessarily increase the sense of exclusion. Rather, we must look to increase the confidence and capability of consumers within our society. However, I recognise that banks are private concerns. As I said, the nature of their business is changing. I want to develop good, open and transparent relationships with the banks so that we fully understand each other. It is important to note that the regulation of, as I've mentioned before, financial services is a reserved matter. However, in recent weeks, and some members called on me to meet with various banks, but I have, at my instigation, Mr. or Principal Deputy Speaker, I've met with Danske Bank, Ulster Bank and the Bank of Ireland, and I have plans to meet with others in the coming weeks. If we can work together, I think our banks can provide great and early insight into our economy and how it is performing in varying sectors. We have to appreciate that as the majority of customers change the way they interact with banks, the nature of banking in Northern Ireland will also change. We need to develop progressive relationships with our high street banks so that they remain mindful of the needs of rural communities and those more vulnerable within our society who face the possibility of living left behind and ultimately financially excluded. Principal Deputy Speaker, many will ask what our consumers really think, and we hear this from our banks that their customers and the data would suggest that this is the case, that consumers are behaving very differently. A survey, though, by the Competition and Markets Authority in April last year showed that 63% of consumers found that having a local convenient branch was very important. There is still a fundamental role for branches in retail banking in Northern Ireland. Consumer Council research from Move Your Money shows that there are some fundamental moments in your financial life where you want to speak to someone face-to-face, such as obviously you might be said, taking out a mortgage. As we know, human contact engenders trust and confidence, and in a rural area, this is an even greater value and sense of community that often depends on a busy, thriving high street, and rural banks are a key element to that. Perhaps one of the most telling results from research carried out by the Consumer Council shows that it is predominantly the more vulnerable in our society, so the elderly, disabled and those on low incomes, that are most adversely affected by bank closures. Whilst unfortunately some branches in Northern Ireland have closed, many others have been refurbished and upgraded, offering more space and meeting rooms so that customers can meet staff. So I think it's important to acknowledge that banks do recognise the need for investment also. So many have asked what we can do to mitigate the impacts of these closures. In Great Britain, as part of the British Banking Association's bank protocol, banks must investigate alternative arrangements for customers before closing the last bank in town. These can include free-to-use cash machines, mobile banking solutions, and the use of local post office branches. Unfortunately, to date, this protocol has not been adopted in Northern Ireland. I think there are some weaknesses with the protocol as it currently exists, and some members have focused on the protocol. It is only a protocol that comes in place, I understand, whenever it's the last bank that is closing in a town. I think we need to be very careful about encouraging and almost opening the floodgates for banks to rush to close banks within rural communities, indeed right across Northern Ireland. But an independent review of the BBA's bank branch protocol was announced in May of this year, and this review will provide proposals for the Northern Ireland High Street banks. It's being led by Professor Russell Griggs, who is a friend of Northern Ireland and has been involved in banking issues in Northern Ireland, and will consider the way banks have applied the protocol, as well as the outcomes for affected customers and communities. Post Office Network has been mentioned by many contributors. It can also provide an important role in solving the problem. With the exception of First Trust, who only provide limited services, all banks operating in Northern Ireland provide access to banking services through post offices. However, more needs to be done in this regard to promote these services, as research by the Consumer Council shows that while satisfaction levels were high with post office banking services, standing at some 81%, only one in four customers had used the post office for banking services. The post office branch network is currently undergoing its own network transformation programme to make it more viable. There are 477 post offices across Northern Ireland. Of these, 326, or 60%, are in rural areas. And the Consumer Council estimates that an additional 10,500 extra opening hours have been added through this process. Principal Deputy Speaker, there is no doubt that access to online banking and financial services is important. Digital services have undoubtedly changed the way consumers engage with banks, and reliable broadband is essential for accessing these services. I very much recognise that some consumers have faced or are facing closure of their bank, local bank may not have access to a reliable broadband or mobile connection that is necessary to properly support online banking. My department administers the Northern Ireland Better Broadband project, and this provides access to subsidised broadband installation to homes and businesses that are unable to access a broadband service with a download speed of at least 2 MB/s. In addition, we are working with Ofcom, the communications regulator, who consulted earlier this year on implementing a UK government proposal for a universal service obligation to give all households a right to request a broadband connection within a reasonable cost threshold and offering speeds of 10 MB/s by 2020. Excuse me. Broadband availability in Northern Ireland is increasing, with 94% of households having access to basic broadband services and some 77% to superfast services. In addition, 72% of people use a smartphone, and significant investments currently underway by mobile network operators aim to address the issue of partial hotspots by 2017. It's envisaged that mobile hotspots will be reduced to 0.3% of landmass by the time these investments are complete. Research from Ofcom shows that 62% of internet users in Northern Ireland do bank online. However, 38% of Northern Ireland consumers said that they still would not be confident in accessing a bank account online. So clearly more work is needed to make this a viable alternative for high street branches. Principal Deputy Speaker, having access to cash machines is also a very real issue for rural areas. Back in 2007, the then Department of Finance and Personnel introduced rate relief measures aimed at businesses in rural areas, and this gave a full exemption from rates to ATMs located in rural areas. The aim of this policy was to encourage and sustain the provision of ATMs in rural areas, and I'm very pleased to say that when the policy was introduced, there were 37 ATMs in rural areas. Today, as a result of that policy, the number of eligible ATMs has increased to 82. I think it's a success story that the Executive have delivered in that regard. Principal Deputy Speaker, the Credit Union Network can also help to support the rural community, and according to the Irish League of Credit Unions, membership has doubled in the past 10 years. Whilst credit unions do not offer the full range of services of a high street bank, their network and the number of people that use their services have an important impact across Northern Ireland. They are often, and most of them are, community founded and locally based, and are an important element in increasing and maintaining financial inclusion across Northern Ireland. Closure of rural banks is understandably a real concern, and I'd like to take this opportunity to thank the Consumer Council in its efforts to work with banks to mitigate the negative impacts and for the research they have carried out into consumer attitudes to banking following recent bank branch closures. Their research showed that 80% of customers had visited a bank branch in the last year. That consumers aged 55 and over are more likely to visit a bank branch than younger customers, and that disabled customers were more likely to be affected by bank branch closures. And the Consumer Council is currently working with the Bank of Ireland around the proposed bank closures to ensure that communities are affected are left resilient to the change. And it has proposed to the Bank of Ireland an action plan which includes suggestions that the bank provides drop-in sessions to give effective consumers information and the ability to access their continue to access their bank account, provide support training to consumers on online banking options, to provide resource packs on information comparing different bank accounts and facilities and switching advice and other methods of payment, and also accessibility audits of the alternative arrangements that are being put in place for disabled consumers. Principal Deputy Speaker, I understand and I accept that as customers we are changing how we interact with banks. An increasing number of us are going online to carry out transactions. I also understand that banks need to lower their cost base and that this can lead to some bank branch closures. However, banks in Northern Ireland have significant decisions to make about how they interact with their customers going forward. Principal Deputy Speaker, I have at times spoken in this post about, yes, growing our economy, but also doing so in a way that serves the common good in Northern Ireland. And what I want us to do as we grow our economy is not lose sight of the values that makes Northern Ireland a special place to live in. And one of those values is the value of community. And we have a very, very strong sense of community in Northern Ireland. Banks are, whether we like them or not, part of that community, and they have a broader responsibility to their customers in Northern Ireland, which sometimes is not always evident from their behaviour. I recognise that it will be a challenge, but I will encourage our banks to ensure that they take informed decisions that take full account of the likely impact on local and particularly rural communities. I will certainly do my best to have a very open door relationship with our banks, because it is vital going forward that we truly understand each other, and it should be a relationship which is mutually beneficial to the needs of the banks and indeed of the wider economy and wider society in Northern Ireland. Principal Deputy Speaker, in conclusion, Northern Ireland needs a strong, vibrant banking sector and effective relationships to ensure that the Northern Ireland economy and our rural communities can continue to grow and prosper. Thank you.
Linda Dillon. I call Linda Dillon.
As has already been outlined by my colleague Caoimhe Archibald, the amendment adds to the motion as there are substantial infrastructural deficits, which mean that internet banking is not accessible to many rural businesses and dwellers. As has already been mentioned, this does not solve the issue for businesses of cash lodgements and withdrawals. Unfortunately, we do not have control of banks and how they choose to deliver their services. However, as customers, there is an expectation that the bank we use can meet our requirements. There needs to be an innovative approach taken on this issue, and the Minister should have proper engagement with banks to discuss how services can be delivered and retained in rural areas. Many examples have been given here today of how that could be done. My own town of Cull Eilidh, which has quite an urban base, is without a bank. And Mr McGlone mentioned earlier on about Mahara. And if you're talking about towns and businesses needing to use internet banking, one whole half of Mahara town doesn't have access to broadband. So one whole half of the businesses in that town don't have access to broadband, so it is impossible for them to do internet banking. And again, as Mr McGlone mentioned about the number of businesses in Mid Ulster, Mid Ulster actually has the largest number of VAT-registered businesses outside of Belfast. It's a very innovative area. It is an area where people got out and got up and started up their own businesses and made that effort, but they feel that they're not getting the support from central government very often in order to be able to remain within Mid Ulster. Also, the issue of generational difficulties was raised today, in that many of our older people have difficulty in accessing internet, and I suppose going to the bank was part of their routine. It was a social thing, and my colleague here, Declan, raised that also. Loss of business in areas where there is no bank, because people do their business where they do their banking. So if you're passing your local town, if you're passing Cull Eilidh to go to Dungannon to do your banking, very often then you'll do your shopping there as well. And that's an issue for businesses who are trying to survive in a very difficult economic climate. Banks can talk the talk about consumer focus, but when it boils right down to it, it's all about the profit, and I think that has been well highlighted here today. Broadband is not a substitute. Online banking is not the answer. But even where it could be used, this can't be availed of in many of our rural areas. The Minister has outlined that viability is the driver for bank closures in this new age of technology. And whilst I accept this may be the fact, I would like to highlight that is the fact in big towns and cities where there is good internet connection, not in rural areas. And it's already been pointed out by several speakers, the new age of technology has not yet reached many of our rural areas. The stats that the Minister has given today I would have some questions over, because I can assure you that 94% of the homes and businesses across Mid Ulster and many, many other areas of rural north do not have any decent standard of broadband. Those that have broadband at all, many of them, it's so poor that you couldn't actually use it. So I think that those stats need to be questioned, and I wonder how, were they rural-proofed? Have they been checked against what is actually available within rural areas of the north, rather than just taking an average rate across the north? Because I would definitely question those statistics. I would like to commend the amendment, and I hope that we will get support for it in this House, given that there is an issue, and the motion today is about rural areas and about protecting rural areas, standing up for rural areas, looking after rural areas. So we need to be looking at everything. In addition to the bank closures, there is the issue of the broadband connection and all of the infrastructure that we have been left without right across rural parts of the north for many, many years. And whilst we're trying to address it now that we have people here in a legislative assembly that can actually do something about it, the many, many years of neglect have left its mark. Thank you.
Colin McGrath. I call Colin McGrath to wind on the debate.
Thank you very much, Deputy Speaker. And I suppose in opening, to wind up at this debate, the most striking thing has been how consistent the remarks have been from right across the House, which I think goes to show that the issue affects the greater population of the North. And I think that that's something that is striking, that this affects many, many people. Most of us have representatives, as representatives know in our community, people that are directly affected by this. Whenever I look back to the beginning of the debate from my colleague, Richie McPhillips, you know, taking somewhere like Baleek and having 7,000 people mobilised to be able to sign petitions, that's a huge population in a rural area that are concerned and feel that they are going to lose out in services. To summarise some of the issues that have been raised then, if I go back to Keith Archibald, who talked about the issue of the broadband and how it adds to this, I'll probably come back to it a little bit more towards the end, and I think that there's nothing in there, I suppose, initially that you could disagree with, but one would have to question how it sits alongside the particular motion that we have. But you did mention important things for rural communities, such as the access to transport, and we do know that transport in the rural area is a big issue, and it would have a direct impact if we start moving banks 20 and 30 miles away from people. Another issue that was mentioned by Kiva was the issue of footfall that is brought into towns, into villages, and that footfall uses the bank, and then we hope uses the shops that are next door, uses the shops that are across the road, getting people into towns for one particular reason and then getting them to use their money for other reasons is something that we all aspire as representatives in our communities, and it would be impacted if you start reducing services. Mr. Buchanan referred to the emotive issue of closing services that are in the rural area and how that leads to fear, particularly amongst our older population. And really, I suppose what we're saying there is, do we want to be seen to be sitting back and doing nothing whenever a sector is consistently closing down services, which is resulting in fear amongst our older population? It doesn't seem a very good thing to do, just to sit back and do nothing. I know at that stage there was an intervention from my colleague Daniel McCrossan that said about the 8 additional closures by the Bank of Ireland, and highlighting that the 8 additional closures are not for profit reasons. Those 8 banks are actually managing to deliver a profit for the bank. So if it's not for profit reasons, you know, why are they taking these services out of the rural area? It seems very, very strange, and I think that's something that maybe the department would be able to address and discuss to find out what the motivation for it is. Rosemary Barton then made her contributions to discuss about how there is a change, and acknowledging the change that there is within how we actually carry out our banking world, but that the onus should be on banks to provide at least one bank within each village, because it does feel that they are running away from the rural community. And if they all run away, is it not something that they could get together and try and maintain a network of branches across the whole of our rural community? She also highlighted for the residents of Baleek that having to go 25 miles to be able to go to get to your next bank and then 25 miles back, a 50-mile round journey. Madam Deputy Speaker, my bank is about a third of a mile from my front door, and I detest having to go down to the bank and go in and go through that process, but it has to be done, and it's a third of a mile away from me. Imagine having to do a 50-mile round journey to lodge a cheque. You know, it really is not something that's very serviceable for people. And I know that she has called on the executive to meet with the Bank of Ireland, and I would hope, and I know that the minister outlined that he has met with a number of them, and I hope that that can be extended across. Then Kelly Armstrong gave her contributions and highlighted the Federation of Small Business issue about how this is disproportionately impacting the rural area. Again, a theme that has been picked up by a number of the contributors today. And I know, I think it was Declan that brought in the contribution that we do have a rural proofing that was passed about a year ago in the Assembly, saying that with government services we should be very careful not to walk away from the rural community. So again, it's the importance of us as an Assembly saying that we're not just going to sit back and let the private sector turn its back on the rural community. We want to try and do what we can to try and service and support those in rural areas. Kelly also raised the issue, and I think this is an issue that will resonate with the public in a great way. We stuck by the banks whenever they made huge profits and bust just about everything else. And you stuck by, and the rural people stuck by their banks. Now what we're asking for the banks to do is, whenever it's not an issue of profits, stick by your customers. And I think it's a very important message, you know, that the people did what they could, and now they're asking the banks to do their bit. There's also then reference to older people and interacting with technology. It's not an easy task for older people to go to online banking. It's not necessarily an easy task for younger people to do either. They sometimes have to get down to a branch to try and get issues sorted out. I think the issue that people have raised that's important is when it's required, you like to have the face-to-face contact. And if it's not an issue of profits, we're asking why can that service not be passed round. William Irwin made the contributions about highlighting the issue of the loss to rural areas. Again, a common theme that's coming through, how rural communities are really feeling that they are losing out. And also, again, introduced the issue of large profits that the banks are making. And if they're making these large profits, what are they going to give back to the community? Where is the social responsibility that big businesses that are in our place, where is their responsibility to local people? We also heard then about the community being let down from Declan McLear. Again, the issue of the social responsibility and the importance as well about how many in deprived areas are going to be the people that are going to lose out. And it's the fact that we seem to pick the services from the banks are picking on those that are the most vulnerable. And is that really a responsible thing for banks to be doing? Gordon Dunn highlighted for us that 77 branches have closed in Northern Ireland in the last number of years. If that was any other service, I think we would all be getting quite exercised. That 77, a network of 77 of anything across the north to be lost is a big disappointment, and it's going to have a big effect. So I think it's timely that this motion was brought here today. Also discussed again the issue about online banking and what about those that don't have the skills. And again, that's not just the elderly community, but maybe people that aren't able to, with literacy levels, numeracy levels, people maybe aren't able just to go onto an app and sort out their bank as quick as others can. And if those people are then being left with big journeys that they have to undertake, it's that sense of unfairness that was being mentioned. And as well as that, you talked about the lack of consultation, because I think if there was a true and a proper consultation by the banks in rural areas, they would have heard loud and clear all of these issues over and over again, which may have made them think twice about what they were doing. Steve Aiken mentioned about customers. 68% of customers had attended a bank in the previous month. And we did get a couple of statistics from a number of members, which is highlighting that the branches are being used. It's not that they're lying empty. People are going to them. People are wanting to use them. And they're not losing profits. So really, what is this actually all about? My colleague Patsy McGlone said that this isn't just a Bank of Ireland issue, and I think that's important. It's all banks seem to be reducing their provisions within the rural communities, and I think we need to address this. And I know that the Minister mentioned that he has met with a number of banks, that it is across the whole platform of bank service. He referred to as well the gradual retreat from rural areas, and that's something that we want to try and reverse. We don't want to be sitting back and allowing a gradual retreat of anything from our rural communities. The Minister then has acknowledged that there is a change in how we are carrying out our banks and how we are carrying out our banking, and that therefore it is something that the banks may have to address. But you did acknowledge the impact of bank closures and the effect that it has. And I like the bit that was mentioned about the unbanked community, those that aren't members of banks. It's 10%, which is very high. So what are we going to actually do to encourage them to come in and be part of banks if we're starting to reduce the visibility of the banks within our community? So, and I hope that those meetings with banks can continue, that we can try and impress upon them from the elected representatives of Northern Ireland the need that there is for those banks to be in rural communities. To very quickly refer to the amendment that was made, we don't want to confuse this issue, and that's why we're not going to be supporting it. This is not about broadband, and I take the spirit in which the amendment was given, but you know, the opening line is this Assembly is extremely concerned at the number of bank closures, branches that have been closed in rural areas. It's not about online banking. To possibly confuse the two, because if we ended up with super broadband right across the whole of the north, we would still have bank branches closing, and we're saying that that's not good, that it's not good for footfall, that it's not good for our communities, that it's not good for our elderly people, and because it doesn't address all of those issues, we won't be able to support that. But we commend the original motion to the House and hope that we can get the full support for it. Thank you very much.
The question is that the amendment standing on the marshal list be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
Aye.
I think the ayes have it.
Aye.
I think. Okay, clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes. So. Order. Order. Members will resume their seats. Order. Members will resume their seats. The question is that the amendment standing on the Marshall list be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary if any, no.
No.
I think the ayes have it. Do we have tellers? Order. Tellers have been appointed. Order. Can members resume their seats, please? Order. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Declan McAleer and Caoimhe Archibald. Tellers for the noes are Gerry Mullen and Colin McGrath. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left.
secure the doors. Order. Members will resume their seats. Can I ask all members to resume their seats? Can the clerk please read the result?
70 members voted, 48 members voted aye, 22 members voted no. The amendment is therefore agreed.
The amendment is agreed. The question is that the motion as amended be agreed. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, if any, no. I think the ayes have it.